Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. We are live here at Gamescom from the ESL studios. My name is Semler. With me is Anders, and this is the second major of the year for Counter-Strike Global Offensive.
Yes, and it's the third major in total, of course. It's going to be absolutely brilliant. This is going to be a bit of a milestone, I feel like, Semler.
This is it, man. We're finally there, the second major, and it's just really hard to control yourself, man, because this is such an exciting event. This is it. This is what we've all been waiting for. We've got the 16 best teams in the world here. I mean, we have a team from India, Anders. This is it. It's continental. This is it, man. We're getting everybody in.
Absolutely everyone that you can wish for. Really not a team that should be at it that you can point out and say, oh, we're sort of missing this team. They're all right here. And it is going to be completely devastating as well, because this is a really, really tough tournament.
Man, just when the groups were announced, you know, just weeks ago, you already looked at it and you're just like, this is perfection. This is perfect. Every group, there's going to be upsets in every group. This is it. You have like 3-4 teams that should make it out of the group phase, and you're going to have two of them going home. It's cutthroat. Two losses and they're out. But let's go ahead and take a look at the groups real quick before we get into things here, because we are pretty much on time, more or less, kind of.
So more or less.
We're getting there.
You know, we have this new GoTV system, which I'm not sure is fully functional just yet, but obviously we have representatives from Valve here at Gamescom who are going to help us out with it, so we'll do it. But Group A is the one we're going to start off with NIP, HellRaisers, Epsilon, and Team Wolf, which has a slightly longer name, but we're going to call them Wolf a little bit easier, and that is the Indian team that you're talking about.
That's it. They qualify through the Indian qualifier. They managed to make it through here. That was the spot that actually went on to replace LGB. Mm. If anybody remembers from Katowice, LGB was in the top A bracket. Yep. They kind of broke up, though. I mean, we're going to see some of their players in the matches throughout the group today, but that team actually fell apart. So they opened up the spot, and they made it possible for another team to actually get in here and compete, which is awesome, because we don't get to see Indian players all that often.
No, and the thing is, when you have a title like Global Offensive for your game, the game really should be global, and you know, inviting a team from India, I think, is a really great move. I enjoy that so much. So, I mean, now if we can just keep on expanding and getting more and more you know, continents in, it's going to be amazing. I look forward to that. And obviously, the way we're going to do this is the first 2 days we're going to be doing group stages, guys, which means we'll cover 8 games total per day. That's 4 games per group, and there's 5 games total in a group, so we're going to have to choose between the first 2, but then we'll do winner's match, loser's match, and you know, the final one as well. So it's going to be good.
Hard decisions will be made, but that's going to be the program for today, basically. So there's going to be 2 groups. I mean, basically, we're going to go through all 4 groups today, but 2 of those matches, the first 2 matches of each group, are going to be played simultaneously. So we're going to have to pick one of them, but you know, I think we'll be pretty on point. We'll try and do our best there.
Yeah.
But throughout the rest of this tournament, we're going to get every game. There's not going to be a single game missed. So that's the real beauty of it. Having that extra day here at Gamescom really lets us spread everything out and do it right.
Yeah, we can cover all the quarterfinals matches as well. Yeah, it's gonna be so sick. But now I actually think we can switch it into the game, because we're already going live with it here, and it is gonna be on Inferno between Epsilon and HellRaisers. So a big welcome to all of you, and a big thanks for staying up. I've already received so many tweets from people saying, "Look, you know, I'm in the US. It's 3 a.m, and I gotta stay up and watch." So big thanks to all of you for either getting up really early in Europe or staying up till really late in the US. You guys are amazing, and this tournament is gonna be off the hook. Now, here we come. It's going to be Epsilon starting on the counter-terrorist side and HellRaisers starting on the terrorist side. Semler, who do you favor to win this game?
Oh, man, it's so hard to call, man. It's so hard to call. We've seen so many good games from Epsilon in recent times. I mean, just last week we had G3, and these guys actually played really well. They had an upset match to start their tournament against NiP. If you can take NiP in a best of one in a group stage, right now in a group stage here where it's just this is the match to determine winner match, anything is possible with Epsilon. We've seen sick play from FXO, and hopefully we're going to see sick play from Shoxi. I think that's who everybody's going to be watching this tournament all tournament long. Is Shoxi going to be up to snuff for Epsilon? If he is, they're definitely a force to be reckoned with. You cannot count them out.
And Epsilon beat HellRaisers on LAN, and that wasn't even with FXO on the lineup. So I don't know. This is going to be a scary game, I think, for HellRaisers. But on the other hand, the CIS team has been practicing at an absolutely godlike level. They've been putting in something like 10 hours a day for the last 2 weeks, which is, I think, going to have a big impact. I'm going to put HellRaisers a little bit on top. Here it is. GMX is actually going to be the first one going down. Almost had a good angle. Now SF in some trouble over here, but it's going to be the push to the A bomb site that really matters. There's Kucha going down. Doja taking down Super. No, that's Kiyoshima, sorry. And it's going to be a 2-on-3. Actually, now a 1-on-3 is Shoxi. He's going to be alone. Great headshot. The bomb is not going to go down. And that's the round one. There's no time left. Shoxi with the triple kill, leaving Doja alone. And what a way to start for Epsilon.
This is it. Shoxi We were wondering if he was going to do it, but it comes down to him in a 1v3. Too late coming over from that B site. You have to appreciate a bit of the strategy there from HellRaisers, though. It seems like Epsilon, they really didn't know what to expect. They saw two guys at B, they saw two guys at A. It was just like, where is it going down? But in the end, they actually managed to weather the storm, and Epsilon will pick up the first round here, their first round of this tournament. And that is just a fantastic start for this French team, who, you know, some would say are going to be, you know, third seed in this group. It's going to be tough for them to get out. But this is how they need to start. They need to start strong and pick up that first round.
I would put them third seed in the group. I agree with that assessment. And I actually think HellRaisers made a mistake not checking the site. Obviously, that's part of the problem is that they had so little time. But the CSET 75 Strikes. Comes into play. And in the middle, FX Joe's got to be really careful. He's going to take down the first two players with the FAMAS, pulls out the pistol, and he's going to be exchanging places with them in the smoke. He's finally going to go down to Doja. And this round should still be manageable. Shoxi in the pit doing work, taking down Kucha, leaving Doja in a 1-on-3 here with a FAMAS picked up, though.
Yeah, with a FAMAS now. He's actually got the gun, and he's got armor as well. No head armor for him, though, but still, he has the opportunity to do some damage. Shoxi's actually moving up into apartments right now, trying to hunt him down, essentially. So we'll see if Shoxi can find the right angle, catch Doja off guard. If he reads it right, and he is going to be heading back over to second mid. But in the meantime, SF over is going to get picked off by Doja. So again, this is looking like a really strong second round here for HellRaisers. The anti-eco not really going Epsilon's way at all here, already giving up 3 kills.
And this is really, really not bad for HellRaisers. Shoxi will take the last kill there, so that's obviously a good job on his part. And what's his total kills right now, I'm wondering? So he's 6-0-0.
Yeah.
Definitely not bad to start off with. Well, last time when Epsilon beat HellRaisers on LAN, Shoxi dropped more than 30 kills in one game.
Was it 30-3?
Yeah, it was like 31-3 or something. Absolutely ridiculous like that. A truly, you know, unique performance almost. And but we'll see if he can, you know, make it do it again. If he can, that could be one way that Epsilon can win this. HellRaisers, on the other hand, they managed to get 3 kills in, and this is really important because come the fourth round, not this one, but the next one where they can buy once again, if they can manage to get that round home, there's a really good chance that Epsilon are going to be ecoing straight away, and that is not good for the French team.
Exactly. It's huge. Just making sure they spend that money, but Shoxi's moved back into position in pit, and he gets 3 kills, wraps up the headshots. No Kevlar this time bought for HellRaisers because they are ecoing for that fourth round buy, but still, this is very clean work from Shoxi. GMX, the opportunity this time, and he doesn't go down. He gets the kill. So that's the kind of third round that Epsilon were looking for here, not dropping a single man. That's actually making up quite a bit for the last round that they had a bit of trouble on, but now, Anders, we get into that fourth round buy for HellRaisers. They're going to go full AKs, and they actually have quite a few nades as well. So this is going to be the big round here. If Epsilon manage to close this out, that is just a perfect start, because we're always talking about how momentum is so important, especially in these best of one tournament matches. You want to get that strong start and get those crucial rounds at the beginning. If Epsilon pick up the fourth round buy, that is huge for them.
And because they just had a round where they lost nobody, that actually sort of almost makes up for the fact that they lost so many people in the other round. Now they can lose and still buy. So this is hugely important here. Very interesting start to the game, of course. We're in the fourth round, and HellRaisers predictably playing this one really slowly. That is something they're well known for doing. Kind of like Na'Vi, maybe it's a CIS type thing, but they generally can be a slow team as well, on the terrorist side at least.
It's true. HellRaisers do like to take their time. But what I'm wondering right now is, you know, they're taking their time, but is it in the back of their heads that Shoxi has 9-0-0 right now? And, you know, is it happening again?
Well, I think at this level, You can't worry about it too much. I've always tried to ask pro players about this, and the response I get a lot is that we don't actually notice that much who's killing us. Mm-hmm. But obviously, at one point, you know that there is that Shoxi factor out there somewhere.
I would believe that, except that you watch nine players out of 10. All they do when they're dead is they're spamming the scoreboard, looking at like what's going on, right? And if Shoxi's sitting at the top of that scoreboard, that's definitely... I mean, when you've taken a beating like that at Valencia, HellRaisers, you know, that's not something you forget very soon, so... The thing is that we did get a chance to talk with HellRaisers a little bit, and they are super prepped for this. But now we have the play beginning here for A, and this is just Markolov causing a bit of a distraction over here. He jumps out of apartments, takes some shots, and that's actually going to delay the rotation here towards the B side from Epsilon. It's going to be down to SF and Super, and can they hold?
Well, good kill coming in onto Adrian there, and that's a bomb down as well. And look at that time left. Super Fighter picking up 3 kills in quick succession, and is going to take down Markolov. So that's an absolutely brilliant quad kill coming in here. And HellRaisers leaving themselves so little time. And this play, I think, actually, again, kind of like in the pistol round, this was basically based on the idea that Epsilon had to do a quick rotation. Markolov flashed himself out of apartments and jumped in, which actually was a really sort of a bold move. He was alone over there. And I would actually have thought maybe Epsilon would have put one of the guys in B towards Speedway, like at least try and move a little bit. And if they had been moving out just as the other people moved into B, it would have been great timing for HellRaisers. But because Epsilon kept it cool, nobody moved. In the end, Markolov's, you know, trick didn't really play out at all, and that just meant they got mowed down.
Yeah, they really needed to leave themselves another 10 seconds on the clock there to have a little bit of movement, a little bit of room to play around with. But we'll see if HellRaisers can recover here. But that is the fourth round bye picked up here for Epsilon Esports. So that very strong start already going their way on the CT side of Inferno as well. But FX at mid, he's going to manage to get back around this corner and stay alive. So no return frag for HellRaisers, which is going to be a little bit frustrating for them. They need to get some damage done here on Epsilon. They need to at least pick up a couple kills this round to really make it worth their while.
Yeah, they do. Actually, I think the eco kills coming in here are going to be really important for HellRaisers right now, because the money that's starting to build up at this point is probably going to be a little bit scary for Epsilon. As they make it 5-0 and have another flawless round, this time with FXGO picking up a quad kill, which also means that sort of the entirety of the Epsilon squad is starting to really get more healthy and start feeling more confident in themselves.
If you're looking at the money right now on Epsilon, and if you're a player on Epsilon looking at the money, you're pretty happy with the situation, right? GMX still has that FAMAS. Like, that's how happy you are right now. You're like, okay, we've got like two solid buy rounds. Even if we were to lose this one, HellRaisers, they're not going to be able to run away with it and get free rounds. They're going to have to deal with us buying up several times before they can really get an easy round out of us on an eco.
And FXGO hasn't even had to resort to buying an AWP yet. They still have that, you know, ace up their sleeve. If things start going south, they can maybe do that. So that's another scary factor as well. But we'll see. Almost the entry frag there going to go into towards SF. That would have been a really, really great opening kill and exactly what they needed. And this kind of, you know, this kind of banana play is like classic Inferno, isn't it? We see that so often, and it's because it works, of course.
Well, now HellRaisers. I mean, HellRaisers, they're really just trying to spread out across. They still have a minute left on this clock. So in this buy round, they really shouldn't be trying to stress out. They really should not be trying to rush and push things. They just need to take their time and bully Epsilon around. And we're already seeing, I mean, GMX taking a damage up in apartments again. With that FAMAS in hand, Markolov is going to force him back around the corner, and that's going to force a nade out of Epsilon. But now we start getting into the crunch time here. 45 seconds left, and now HellRaisers really have to start making a decision as to where they want to take this.
So far, they've lost, well, maybe not entirely, but they've been heavily pressured by having so little time left. So you got to worry for HellRaisers if they keep running into the same issue. But this push to Ace should be really powerful. There's only two people defending, and GMX is one of them with a FAMAS up here. Flashbang goes through, another flash, and there was connects perfectly, really well timed. Now it's just Shoxi inside this bomb site all alone. Backup is coming quick. The bomb is going to go down, and I think they've even heard that Shoxi's in here. Markolov is up in the graveyard. He's going to go down. Shoxi with a great shot, keeps spamming through, almost takes down another player. It's a 4-on-4 here, and the bomb is ticking away.
ISF in that position gets caught by Dozier very easily. Shoxi nearly going to pick up another one here. Adrian's going to dart past, but he is finally going to get overwhelmed, and HellRaisers making a real fight out of this. It's going to be FX and Kyoshima to roll in and get two big frags as well. Brings it back to a 2-on-2, but the bomb is ticked so far down, and the afterplant positions right now for HellRaisers are near perfect. Dozier and Adrian have a great crossfire on that bomb, and there's no way FX can get in here and get this job done.
No, he's going to die with the bomb. He wants to get a pickoff, but it's not going to happen. So great round coming out from HellRaisers. And a variation of an A push that we actually really often credit to the Fnatic lineup. They did the smoke in front of the bomb site. They planted not in what we call the default plant, but a little bit to the left of it. So that actually exposed them to very little risk because they had the pit under control. So they almost could be 100% sure they could get that plant in. The only way Epsilon could have stopped that was jumping up on the box. And that way you expose yourself to all sorts of dangers.
You could see it going through Shoxi's mind as well. From his position on that site, he looked as soon as that bomb started going down. He's like, oh, okay, I actually can't do anything about this. But here we go. This is what we were talking about earlier. FXGO, he's one of the oppers in this game who is not afraid of using the sniper rifle on Inferno. It's something that we don't normally see from most offers. I mean, you have Kenny S maybe who will go to it, Guardian as well, but it's not that common. So FX is a man who can actually make it work, and we'll see if this change of pace here from Epsilon is actually going to pay off for them, because now this is when Epsilon really need to put HellRaisers down. Okay, you've won a round, HellRaisers. If they lose this follow-up round, they're back to $1,400 starting money in the next round, and that's pretty much another eco here for Epsilon.
Absolutely brilliant. There's a bit of a pop flash into the apartments, just a bit of an attempted peek from GMX, but instead he gets shot a little bit to the body from Markolov's AK. But again, a really standard trick coming in from Epsilon, and I like the fact that they're trying stuff like that. You know, one guy throwing a flash into apartments, other guy peeking. Again, this is sort of basic Counter-Strike stuff, but there is a I mean, again, the basics, they really work, and I love the fact that Epsilon are doing stuff like that. FXJO, inside the library here, maybe going to get smoked off here, in fact, and wondering if he can take a shot through. There's the smoke off, and he's not even going to attempt it.
Oh, but he's going to manage to get around in this position. He's already looking towards Arch as well. If they come darting around here, he's going to find them. Takes a shot, misses it, though. And that's not going to help things for Epsilon. He's going to get chased down. Angel finds one with a wall bang. Shoxi manages to catch Adrian, however, so it's a quick one for one. We're back into a 4-on-4, but Epsilon have given up the B-side proper. They're waiting in construction.
Yeah, and this is a really good setup here. 8 seconds left, and Superfight is going to take down Angel. They are going to get the bomb down, but I'm not sure they can hold this, especially with Kiyoshima coming with the kill. Kucha finally taking one every turn, but it will be Doja in a 1-on-3. And in this corner, he really can't do much of anything. He's going to go down to DMX, and it's going to be a defuse happening eventually from DMX. So I think actually something went wrong with FXJO's keyboard or mouse then. It looked like he wasn't aiming where he wanted to aim. That looked really weird. Mm-hmm. Really great that Shanxi picked up the kill, because that kill allowed them to know for sure that it was going to be a B push, because they checked everywhere else. They knew that there was going to be a B push happening, and they set up in construction to wait for it. Actually, yeah. Very, very smart decision-making from Epsilon.
The 1-2 tag as well from there. I mean, Kiyoshima peeks the first man, and that sets it up for SF, who was waiting in the corner, so the bait and switch, and then yeah. It was just really well played there from Epsilon, keeping cool. Especially when HellRaisers are trying to throw a curveball like that. It's not often that you actually see the T side try and run through CT spawn to get that sandwich going on the B side defenders. But this time around, Epsilon knew how to handle it, no problem at all. And this really puts the pressure back on HellRaisers now, because they had enough money to be getting a buy, but now this is pretty much all their money spent on this round. If Epsilon picked them up here and no plant for HellRaisers, it's going to be a very sad time for them.
A great opening from Superfight. It takes down Doja and Kucha both over at the B bomb site. So that's exactly the opposite of what HellRaisers wanted. They wanted Doja to get that pick off like he almost got a couple of rounds ago, but it just backfires on them horribly, which is a real shame, because if they lose this round, HellRaisers, I'm almost 100% sure they're going to have to eco. They just can't have the money any longer to buy. The only reason they had the money to buy this round, I think, is because they at least got the bomb plant in the last round for that $800 bonus. They realize the orb is going to be up there, and once again, they're going to try and smoke it off and see if they could do something else. But this is a 5-on-3 and a very almost impossible round to win at this point. They just don't have a lot of time, and they don't have any more grenades, except the two flashbangs left here.
Yeah. Oh, GMX getting the kill on Angel with that AK picked up. But the two defenders here for the B side are holding so solidly. SF and Kiyoshima really playing this well. Adrian's going to get picked off immediately by Kiyoshima, and Kiyoshima walks in and gets the double kill. So HellRaisers, they get just bogged down after the initial exchange, but that was a very cool hold that gave Epsilon the first two kills. The fact that they were holding both of them out in the open like that, you know, usually when you're taking that peek towards B-side from Banana, you're expecting one guy to be holding CT, and I'm sure that's what Doja was expecting. He peeks out and he's just looking, he expects to be looking down the barrel of one gun. Instead, he's greeted with two. I think the real issue is HellRaisers trying to force it there and giving away those two frags. You know, instead of backing off and just playing a man down, they tried to force the issue, and then they get punished for it. That leaves the three remaining members just out in the open. But FX going for a bit of a Kenny smoke here, looking towards second mid. That's really nice with this AWP. And he is not actually managing to connect with too many shots right now. He needs to get warmed up a little bit, it seems.
Yeah, maybe a little bit, you know, some nerves as well. Although we did see FXJO Dfinity playing really well on LAN, which was one of the big question marks for Epsilon going into their first LAN tournament. Because obviously online, we'd seen him just tear teams apart almost single-handedly sometimes. Kind of, you know, almost like having a second Shoxi just with an AWP instead. And that was impressive. But there's always the question, is it going to be the same on LAN? And for FXJO, it seemed to really be the case. And if he could do it, not just at a LAN, but at a major tournament, that would be something truly different.
Oh, you hit the nail on the head right there, man. I mean, that's the thing. At LAN, yes, big, but Major is a totally different beast. 250 grand on the line. That's going to put some pressure on you like no other. But there we go. FX manages to pick up two. He goes for the no scope. Not going to get it, but he's still alive. Kucher goes for the knife, and he's not going to get the kill. FXO just barely hangs in there. And, well, you know, we were kind of putting a little bit of pressure on him there, and he steps up and gets three eco frags. So that'll make him feel a little bit better. You know, he gets some kills.
Oh, it's not like he's doing badly. He's at 11 kills and 3 deaths, only outdone by Shoxi at 12 kills and 1 death, which is absurd in itself at this point.
But those two guys, that's what needs to happen here for Epsilon. When we're looking at them, and talking about them, essentially you're thinking, okay, I mean, heavy hitters here. FX, we've seen what he's capable of. Shoxi, everybody knows what he's capable of. If those two guys line up and start really getting frags for Epsilon, this makes them such a difficult team to deal with. And Shoxi even managing to peek into apartments towards second mid, getting a lot of information as to where HellRaisers are on the map right now.
Also, a slightly dangerous. I really disagree with Shoxi doing that. I don't mind him peeking, but it seemed like he was actually taking a fight for a couple of seconds, and I'd rather he didn't, but nothing came of it, so I guess it's all right. If they really wanted someone to peek up there, I'd much rather it be FXJO running up with an AWP trying to take a shot and then running back.
Okay, but that's the first smoke used up on the B site for CT side, so Doja does manage to bait that out. Even if he doesn't pick up a frag, he's still going to get that info. And FXJO just caught completely off guard there.
Double scoping.
Yeah, double. I mean, brave. But, you know, he was really trying to hunt that guy who's going to be pushing down from Banana, which is what his teammates were communicating to him, essentially. He's like, okay, there's a guy going down Banana. FXJO thinks he can get in position to pick it off. But then he gets punished well for it there. So well done by HellRaisers. But Shoxi still manages to get a one-for-one over here on long.
Yeah, it does go down. And actually, not sure that was quite worth it. I think Shoxi maybe got a little bit too brave then. GMX down the pick. Great headshot. Takes down Angel. Goes for a second one. And it's going to be SF to help him out from the library. And now it's just Markolov left. Picked off mid-air headshot from GMX. Very, very nicely done from Epsilon here. 9-1 is a terrific start to this first half. And I think at this point, HellRaisers are going to be ecstatic if they can get up to 4 rounds in total.
Yeah. Yeah, you're. I mean, you're not far off the mark, and especially since their money is just in shambles right now. They don't have anything. 3,000, 3,750 is the most that they have on Kuchar. And HellRaisers are not a team that likes to eco either. They're not a team that likes to play for pistols. We've seen them go for buy rounds like this where they barely have the money to put it together. If you had guys at 3,500, they would be going like Galil, basically, and trying to just get some damage done. But it seems like they're really going to put it all in the last remaining rounds here of this half, HellRaisers, to get what they need. If they could get 5 rounds, if they can somehow figure out how to get the remaining rounds, this would be huge.
And no doubt really frustrating here for HellRaisers, just the idea that they've put in so much practice. And because of the way this format works, you get to lose 2 games and you're out.
Yeah.
And very likely, your next game, if you lose, well, that's pretty going to be against Wolf. I mean, that's the thing. But then you're going to be playing either Epsilon or Nip again to try and make it through.
If Epsilon get through, you know, the game is definitely not over yet, though.
No, definitely not.
Even if they can get, I mean, if they can get 4 rounds, their CT side is not something to be snubbed, you know. So they can definitely do the damage here. But there we go, overwhelming the first man. That's SF, who's peeking towards Banana. He gets picked off immediately, but Kyushima is still alive on the site. And now FXJO has had the time to rotate into support as well. This should be a crossfire setup, and it's going to work perfectly. Kyushima gets the remaining 4 frags.
Wow.
Doesn't even need FXJO to step in. And that's going to be a very clean anti-eco there for Epsilon, only dropping a single man. But money is not a problem for Epsilon at this point. They've had so many rounds go their way. I mean, they're sitting on 10 rounds, but also a few rounds where they've kept so many members alive that we can see it's just completely out of control now. For the rest of this half, they're not going to have to worry.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, HellRaisers have to win rounds based on just getting great pickoffs here now. I mean, get the early kill and then make a decision. I think the obvious choice is the A-bomb site. I feel like B has been too solidly held so far for Epsilon, even if they get in. Epsilon has proven they can retake the site, so I think the A-bomb site is a better choice at that point. And I'm kind of wondering, now they seem to be playing very defensively in the middle. They are trying for the opening kill here. And Doja just going to throw a bit of a grenade in there, not really going to connect with anything.
Well, HellRaisers are a team that really relies on the picks. And that's something we've seen in the past. I mean, they've shown by now that they've got some set strats. And we see one now going in with the smokes going towards that B site. Seems like they really just want to set up and make this play happen here eventually. They've got the smokes covering up towards CT, towards coils. There's the double mollies. And it's going to be the Ring of Fire. We haven't seen this in ages. But now we have to see, does it actually work for HellRaisers here?
Oh, they are going to find SF. Great flashbangs coming. Kyushima goes down, and through the smoke, it's going to be FXJO picking off Kucha. That's a very annoying kill. Bomb will be planted, but it's a 3-on-3, and he has actually rained with the AWP. He's going to miss the shot, and he could have got him killed, but he's going to fall back. GMX takes down Markolov, and now it is a 2-on-3. Angel and Doja left defending, and this is a must-win round for HellRaisers. They have to hold this bomb site. Otherwise, they are probably going to lose this match. Just not good enough otherwise. Angel takes a kill, but then he's going to be alone. He goes down. Shoxi with a second headshot, and HellRaisers, they don't make it happen. 11-1 here, and I think that might be the nail in the coffin. I really have a hard time seeing them coming back. Of course it's possible, but we're talking miracle style comeback here.
Well, we have a pause coming in here during the freeze time now, so we'll see what's coming in. That's actually coming from Epsilon here. So you are able to pause during the freeze time, during the downtime like this, in between rounds. You can't pause during the round.
Yeah,
so that's something to keep in mind. And the players, of course, well, you know, they're fully aware. But yeah, this is a real problem for HellRaisers. At least they get the plant. But even without the plant, they should have been able to get like some kind of buy together. But still, you know, they get the plant, they get the bonus $800 for everybody on the team. So we see that they're going to have plenty of money. But the problem is that they need to get the remaining rounds in the half. Like, they can't not have four. Like, they need more than four rounds, but four rounds is the best they can get at this point.
They get the bomb site, they get the bomb down, and they're in a 3-on-3. And then it just seems like it's so easy for Epsilon to retake the site even then.
Markeloff, that's the thing. Markeloff and Banana there, him getting picked off is what really costs HellRaisers a lot. Because if Markeloff can hold off then, if he stops the man in Banana, he can then set up the crossfire with his teams. You know, two guys on the site, but then him holding from Banana, it's so difficult then for Epsilon to push in from CT, right? But him going down really allows for Epsilon to just close in on that site like sharks. And it is Shark Week, Anders. It is Shark Week.
That's very true. Maybe that's going to be a theme we'll return to later.
What's really scary me is that I don't even have the hat on right now, and Epsilon are doing this. Like, the hat is here, guys. The hat is here. It's in my bag right now. I'm waiting for the right time to crack it out, but look, I guess it's not even necessary.
We have to make this rule, at least if the hat does come into play, you're going to have to tell people before the game so they can adjust their bets accordingly. Otherwise, it's just not fair.
It's just not fair. You're right.
I think CSGO Lounge tweeted something about having like more than $1 million in value on like so far, which is absolutely absurd. Guys, just don't never go all in, all right? Promise me that much. Take care of your skins and all that stuff.
It's crazy that the... hello again, guys. You know, but it's crazy that they're like it's like 1.1 million or something in value right now on CSGO Lounge. That's insane. And so many people are actually getting in on it, too. Yeah. But not only that, in game right now, there's also the Pick'em Challenge that's going with the stickers.
So
you can actually participate in that. I mean, if you have managed to pick up some stickers, the team stickers, it's the same as at Katowice, the same as the DreamHack winner. We have it here again at Gamescom. But you can get the team stickers and then vote basically in game on who's going to win the matches of the day.
And big shout out to Valve for actually putting that in, because that money actually helps to support the teams as well. Mm-hmm. So it's really cool that we have more tools to help the community grow.
You have the keys for the esports cases. You know, a portion of that money is going to fund tournaments like this. But now also, you can actually go and directly support the teams. So if you pick up one of those capsules, out of those eight teams in that capsule, they get a split of that money. And that's, I mean, it's quite a bit of money, you know, at the end. So it really goes a long way to supporting the players and the teams. So that's really cool, everybody actually picking up those capsules.
It definitely does help a lot. So keep doing that, guys, and you know, maybe you can top the leaderboard somewhere with those stickers right there. Apart from that, I feel like one of the big problems here as well is that if you look at the, I mean, obviously we're in studio now, but the actual kills that are happening for HellRaisers are really limited. The most we have right now is 6 on Doja. I mean, and being 12 rounds into the game now, starting on the 13th round, it's just nowhere near enough. They need to actually get pickoffs. They need to actually start killing people. Like, at a very basic level, you can do all the strats you want, but if you don't actually get the kills, it really doesn't matter.
No, but we're talking, like, some teams, that's the thing, some teams would be able to bounce back from that sort of situation, right? You know, teams like Titan, you know, they have the leader, they can really just get them back under control and start grinding out rounds, and you'll have the experience there. I mean, HellRaisers have been playing together for a very long time, but a lot of their play does revolve around them picking up that initial frag, getting that momentum, taking away the control from the opponents, and then just building off of that. And that's like what Doja needs to be doing, or Markeloff up in the apps, like getting into those pick positions and actually managing to pick off GMX, or managing to pick off SF and forcing rotations on Epsilon's side. But we just haven't seen that. It looks like we're back live in the game, though. Not sure what the pause was about, but you know, so long as the game is going, Anders, we're all right, man. We're happy.
Yeah, probably just a minor issue. That's all right. You know, they're all set up in a different place. That's one of the conditions of playing on LAN, you know, not your own keyboard, man. Or maybe sometimes it is, but if it fails, you're going to have to borrow from somebody else, and it's always going to be weird issues. 13th round is coming up here. Doja out on Banana, and he's going to actually be grenaded out. He's going to have to move. He goes down, and then Kucha does pick up the return frag, which is obviously really important. And, well, technically speaking, that's going to go in favor of HellRaisers right up until the point where Markeloff goes down to FXJO's AWP and putting us in a 3-on-4 situation that looked good for about 1 second.
You're talking about the two guys right now on HellRaisers whose roles, it seems, so far have been get in their face and get the picks. And Doja not able to get anything done. I mean, that was pretty much worst case scenario for Doja and Banana. That's when, as you know, that B player, as that point man going up there, and you see three guys on the CT side, you're just like, well, I just got countered. I'm in a rough spot. I need to at least take one out with me. So HellRaisers, at least they managed to turn that into the 1v1, but or 1v1. But Markloff up in AHAPS not getting anything done is definitely hurting HellRaisers here. They're down to three guys, man advantage for Epsilon, and there's still nades on Epsilon's side as well. As we can see, SF is setting up for that smoke that's going to cut off Banana, and HellRaisers are just going to try and rush through, but they could get overwhelmed here.
Great Molotov. SF actually diving into the water to just put the fire out, but it's going to be just fine. Kiyoshima with the pickoff and then double for SF. And once again, that B hold is looking so good for Epsilon that I really don't understand why HellRaisers keep pressing the issue.
Well, look at the thing, though, is that the kills are so consistent across the board for everybody on Epsilon. Right now, HellRaisers, it seemed to me like they thought, okay, let's go A at the start of this game, because it seems like, you know, we were able to actually force GMX off and get him out of the way. Now GMX has woken up. They go to B site, Kiyoshima and SF slamming the door on them.
They're
starting to go like, well, where the hell do we go on this map? Where's the weak link in Epsilon's defense that we can take advantage of, get that free kill and get rolling?
I agree, but I think they've been closer at the A bomb site. Even if just marginally closer, I think at this point that still makes a difference. I would still try and press that A bomb site if I could, but you are right. It's not like it's exactly a weak spot. That would be incorrect to put it like that, but I agree it is looking a little bit difficult in that sense.
Well, it's really tough for HellRaisers because they've gone for pick style, hasn't worked. They've gone for executes, hasn't worked. Smoke rounds, no, it's just they're really trying to go through all their repertoire, and you can see, you know, that they've managed to polish up their game a bit going for these big smoke rounds, these big execute rounds, but we're just not seeing it yet.
The one round that did work involved the forward smoke towards the A-bomb site, where they tried to pick off the people in the pit, then take over the pit and defend it from there. Maybe they just need to do that again. If it worked once, there's absolutely no reason it couldn't work again. But again, it revolves around the early kills. And this time they have the bomb over by Banana, and Markloff doing what he can to try and position himself into something here. There's going to be a smoke over that's going to hit right by the truck towards the pit here. So this is actually, I think, a bit of a fake coming out from HellRaisers. And FXJO, he's going to call their bluff. Picking off one, Markloff is going to get killed by Shox, and that just gives the whole game away. We could be seeing a 14-1 half here.
There's the counter flash, perfectly timed by SF, and he gets the double, the triple spray, which is about as good as it gets. That flash into yellow, completely blinding HellRaisers, and then just keeping his cool. 15-1-5 right now. They're in single-digit death range right now, Epsilon. That's the thing. I mean, Shoxi has died twice. He's at 16-2-2.
Yeah, he might not actually get to repeat his DreamHack Valencia performance just because the game might finish before we actually get to that amount. But this is really impressive. Everyone from Epsilon is playing at a level that is just several levels above what we saw at the Gfinity tournament. So this is very pleasing indeed, and hugely exciting for the Frenchman. There's going to be Adrian finally with the pickoff on FXJO, but instantly returned by GMX in the apartments, and he's going to fall back to a safer position, which is definitely a good idea. So 4-on-4 right here, still more than a minute left, and HellRaisers scrambling to get this last round off the half home. They make it 13-2 instead of 14-1. Psychologically might be a bit of a difference, but Adrian is going to go down. GMX going to peek out of boiler, take down Kucha. Nice headshot. It's going to be Angel and Doja left, and Doja now in a 1-on-3. He dies. GMX will get the quad kill without taking a single point of damage and making it 14-1, and this is looking completely devastating for HellRaisers.
That was so smart by GMX as well. He ran back in apartments, made noise. You heard Adrian. Who heard that? And he's looking towards balcony. He's expecting GMX to come jumping out, and he's going to get that quick trade, right? GMX just stays in there and gets the perfect flank, walks back in and just catches HellRaisers and mauls them. This is calamity time now for HellRaisers. They have one round going into the second half. This is about as good as it gets for Epsilon. Like this first half, CT side of Inferno, you get 14 rounds. If they pick up the pistol, this is gonna be a very quick first map actually here for our second major of the year rather.
Oh yeah, I mean at this point, I don't think we've ever seen, at least I can't remember a single game that I've seen on LAN where someone's made a 14-1 comeback on Inferno. So HellRaisers have that going for them. Yeah. We've seen some 11-4 comebacks with, I think Titan once upset NIP on this map by making a ridiculous 11-4 comeback. But 14-1 is too much to ask for.
Hey, we just have to say the whole Room on Fire crew is here. Because we haven't said, but Ven is here, man. Ven is here, and he's handling the OBS work. So, guys, all the camera work, that's all coming from Vendetta, who's here at Gamescom with us. But the whole Room on Fire crew, all day long, today and tomorrow, we're bringing you the action here at Gamescom.
Yeah, and of course, once again, as we're waiting for the time to run down here, big thanks to all of you for tuning in here. Of course, this is the ESL One Cologne 2014 tournament that you're watching. And we're in Group A right now, the very first game of this whole tournament. And it's going to be running for the next 4 days. And the way we're doing it is it's going to be Semler and I and Vendetta basically handling the first 2 days of group stages, then third and fourth day, we're going to bring in everyone else. That's going to be Scoots, it's going to be Tosspot, it's going to be Richard Lewis, it's going to be Pansy, and it's going to be absolutely great. So you guys, we're going to ramp it up slowly, and it's going to get more and more exciting as well. But here, Epsilon, I mean, I'm actually, like, sometimes when you see a 14-1 performance, you think, wow, this is really tragic, almost disappointing. But right now, I can't help but be super excited about how well Epsilon are playing. I am sad that HellRaisers, because of all the practice they put in, but right now, Epsilon are looking so good. This pistol round is everything for the CIS team, and let's see how it's going to unfold. They start on the CT side here, and Angel will pick up the first kill on GMX, but he might get caught here. Grenade in hand, almost dies to it. Kiyoshima trapped by the tree, and he's actually going to get the return here with the dual elites, and they need to kill him quick before backup arrives. SF goes down, and they do make it out, but FXJO returns on Adrian. What is happening in this round, Semler?
They're all over the place, but I cannot believe that Kiyoshima has picked up dualies, and he's made them work. And he stayed alive long enough for FXJO to get a bait kill as well. That's huge from Epsilon, managing to get their way. I mean, to get themselves out of that position, especially when HellRaisers are rotating guys over. They have two guys sitting at the top of Banana, and somehow Epsilon get out of it scot-free. That is just brutal.
Angel just went back to CT spawn and threw away his C-Sed, which had low bullets in it.
And picked up his USB.
That's a tiny detail that I really love. And risky as well. What if they had pushed B right when it happened? But I think it's a good idea now. We can tell that this is going to be an A push, but Doja doesn't know. He's in the pit, and I love this position. I think this can work out really well for Doja.
Oh, Doja as well. He plays this down. He plays this position so well. He is a force to be reckoned with. But this play from Shoxi, just drawing both of these members over here to the B site, and then he just runs through CT. He's going to be able to close right in, and... oh, HellRaisers, what are they thinking at this point? They have to be going into Banana just trying to get confirmation. And now Doja, he gives it to them. But with 10 seconds left, Kiyoshima picks him off instantly with the dualies. And this is a plant with 5 seconds left on the clock. Just Epsilon are playing at a whole different level.
Yeah, this is just ridiculous. Leaving that little time in a pistol round is really, really brave, but it works out. Angel in a lot of trouble. That flashbang was so good. That bomb plant is really ticking now, and there is a kit on Markolov, but they need to move quick, and Angel goes down, and this is going to be the end. Markolov drops to Shoxi. Great double kill coming out here from the captain, and it's going to be 14-1. 15-1, sorry. That is one hell of a performance from the Frenchman.
This is brutality. This is just vile. And that was at the end. That's like soul shattering for HellRaisers as well, because even coming into that site, it was just perfect flash. Angel can't do anything. Like, it's like Epsilon right now are just playing at a completely different level right now. This is just a pleasure to see, because going into this tournament, you really were wondering, you know, major tournament, are they going to be able to bring it at the same level as they had at G3? And clearly, Shoxi, everybody on the team, in fact, it's not even just Shoxi and FXJO, are playing just perfectly.
And the timing was just absolutely incredible. It's almost like some Mission Impossible type stuff where you have to, you know, you have to open the vault exactly when the time lock changes. It's down to the very last second there. And this round should not be a problem, and it isn't. They've already killed everyone at the B-bomb site. And even then, they're playing so carefully, Epsilon. They're making absolutely sure that there is no window back into this game for HellRaisers. They don't want to throw anything away. They're waiting for HellRaisers to make the mistakes. And Doja, he's going to show himself over at the A-bomb site, and that is... that just might do it here. 2-on-4 is what we're looking at.
He spots the bomb, so that's some information. But still, they are 2-on-4 versus the guns. Markolov with that CZ is going to be able to pick off one man, and they start rotating back towards A. Doja spots this coming, though, so Markolov should be able to come back. I mean, really, at this point, they just need to commit here, HellRaisers. It's going to be an A play. Doja's going to be calling that out to his mate, and he has to haul. But Doja's still managing to bring this to a 1v2 here.
Yeah, Markolov very low on health. He's going to go down, and we're looking at a 16-1 victory for Epsilon, with Shoxi at 19, FXJO at 15, and then, well, actually everyone else is very equal here on this lineup. What an absolutely brilliant performance to start off with. This is, I mean, in terms of who's going to make it out and everything, and who's a contender now to get to quad and even semis, I think Epsilon just took a couple of steps up. What a great match to start off with, even though HellRaisers now are in a very scary position.
Yeah, with how many... Exactly, HellRaisers are... Now, this is the thing. The format for these groups, if in case you're just new tuning in, the format for the group is basically double elimination. We have four teams per group. You win two matches, you're through. You lose two matches, you're out. You're done. And that is how brutal it is here. But we're looking at the bracket now, and we can see... I mean, Nip and Wolf are playing at the same time here. So it looks like we do know what our first winner match will be. Nip versus Epsilon. But the lower match that's going to be coming up next on this stream, Wolf and HellRaisers. Who would have expected HellRaisers to be there?
Definitely not me. I definitely thought HellRaisers was quite favored in this matchup, considering the amount of practice, considering that Epsilon have had some issues before the tournament getting enough practice in.
Yeah.
I thought that was going to play a really big role, but sometimes I guess it doesn't.
That's two tournaments now, back-to-back, where they've won their first game in a very tight match that people would have said their opponents were the favored ones, that it was really going to be Epsilon having to fight. And then Epsilon at G3, they take out Nip in their first game, and here they're doing it again.
Absolutely crazy. So that means the next match we're going to be covering is going to be, are we going to do winners or losers first?
We're going to do lower bracket, or basically the deciding match. The first team out, we're going to find out today. That's going to be up next here on the stream. So it will be HellRaisers versus Wolf. Nip, not sure about the scoreline for the Nip Wolf game.
I think it's
16-7. But 16-7 on Dust 2. That's actually a pretty strong performance from Wolf.
Yeah, that's way more than I thought. Yeah. Way more.
I mean, there's no getting around it. You know, Wolf, you know, it's not a team that we really see often, obviously. I mean, Indian scene, we don't really get to see that often. We don't know exactly what level they're playing at. They did hire Kassad on as a coach. So they got that ex-pro player to come over, basically, and you know, coach them, give them that information, and maybe give them a fighting chance here. But it's still a very, very long shot for Wolf. So we'll see if they can hang on here versus HellRaisers. But I think the big thing here is that, you know, are they able to bounce back and actually recover and make sure that they're not going to be the first team out of Gamescom? Because that's what we're about to find out next.
I mean, that's going to be scary if that's what's going to happen. Of course, we'll go to a really quick break before we do that. But we'll be right back with the losers match. So don't go anywhere. Gamescom 2014. Stay tuned, guys.